Our next speaker is Oded Regev. He's going to talk about strong reverse Minkowski type inequalities for lattices.
Okay. Good. Okay, so hi, everyone. So I'll tell you about joint work with Daniel Dadouche, who couldn't be here because he's giving a similar talk now in Cargès in Corsica. Not that I'm envious or anything, New Brunswick is great, but that's where he is now. This is something that's the question that we've been working on for while Daniel was a postdoc with us at NYU for like about two or two and something years. It's a very basic question about lattices. This is something that people could have asked somewhere like in the early 20th century. No one did. The others did, and I'll tell you what we did with that. So what is a lattice? Let me start with that. You don't need to know much about this, just lattices and determinants, that's all you have to know. So this is a lattice, a set of all integer combinations of n linearly independent vectors. If you ever heard me give a talk, I always start with the definition of a lattice, so you already know it by now. If not, this is a definition. And the most famous lattice, the celebrity here, is just Zn. So the set of all integer points is a lattice. Okay, it's actually going to play an important role in this talk. It's a famous lattice. And a brief history, where I can't go back to Abraham's time 5 millennia ago, like in Simon's talk, if you've been here, but I can go back to the Greek, and Euclid basically thought about similar questions when he talked about the GCD algorithm. It's a one-dimensional lattice. Gauss had already established the more geometric picture in two dimensions, and more recently, many people, Hermit, Minkowski, Itai, worked in this area, Kanan, Lenzer Lovas, Michancho, Subhash Kot, Henry Kohn, and Vyazovska recently solved the sphere packing question. It's a very brief history. Lots of work in this area. Applications are everywhere. Lattices show up a lot in mathematics. Historically, it started in number theory, specific algebraic number theory. Lots of great work there. Diophantine approximation and many, many other areas. And generally, this work and this conjecture, because we feel it's so fundamental, led us to lots of errors in mathematics. So during those 2 years, we had lots of fun learning about convex geometry, additive combinatorics, Markov chains, dynamical systems, coding theory, number theory, and function analysis. So we had lots of fun. You'll see more of that later. I'm not sure about the last one. One day, maybe. It's my wish, my goal in life. The basic question in this area is counting lattice points. So Gauss already thought about that. Basically, you take a lattice, you have a ball of some radius r, and you're kind of asking about number of points in this ball. This is the most basic question that basically many of these questions are around that. And perhaps a special case of that is, so we want the cardinality of the set. A special case of that is the shortest vector problem or the sphere packing question, which asks for the largest ball that contains no lattice points. Well, you always have the origin, so I mean no non-trivial lattice point. This is the sphere packing question. There's a whole book about that by Conway and Sloan, containing tons of examples, calculations, and it's, you know, people spent all their career on investigating that in all sorts of settings. So this is the sphere packing question, basically how big of a ball you can take around the origin that contains no non-zero lattice points. To be precise, to make it precise, I do have to define one thing. That's the only definition you need to know for this talk, and this is the notion of determinant. Otherwise, this question doesn't make sense, right? You can always take a lattice and just blow it up, you know, expand it by some huge factor, and then you won't have any points around the origin. To make sense of this question, you have to normalize. Just like when you're dealing with coding theory, you want to normalize the rank. So this is our normalization. It's called the determinant. So determinant is a very natural notion of density. Basically, you take a ball, and you want to take a big ball, so this is not big enough, let's make it bigger, and maybe even a bit bigger. So kind of let the radius go to infinity and consider the volume of the ball divided by the number of lattice points in it. So basically determinant is the amount of volume occupied per lattice point. Okay, that's it. And we usually assume determinant is one. This is a scaling. We assume things are scaled to have determinant one. Okay, so this is determinant. It's called determinant because it happens to also be determinant of the basis, if you know about that, but you don't have to worry about that. Okay, so this is determinant, and going back, so determinant is a measure of the global density of the lattice, kind of the volume occupied by each lattice point, And going back now a century, Minkowski said somewhere around 1890, he said, you know, take any lattice with determinant 1, normalize it to have determinant 1. He said, once you take a ball of radius square root n, you're going to see lots of lattice points. You're going to see, in fact, 2 to the n lattice points. So this is a statement in 1891. Minkowski said, if you take a ball of radius square root n, you have lots of lattice points there. And one way of explaining this informally is to say, if you have global density, if you know the determinant is 1, so you know kind of globally there's 1 lattice point per unit volume, Minkowski tells us you're going to see it not too far away from the origin. You're going to see it in a radius of square root n. You start seeing lots of lattice points, no matter what lattice you have. And lots of work in this area on sphere packing tries to find lattices that minimize this number. You want as few points as possible, the minimum number of points in a ball, because that's considered a good lattice, like a good code. You want as few short vectors as possible. This is one main theme in this area. But it's been like that for a century and almost a century and a quarter. And then, 120 years later, came Daniel Dadush and asked the converse. He basically asked, you know, is the converse also true? If I have lots of lattice points, if close to the origin, I have lots of points in a ball of radius square root n, does it mean that I have global density? Does it mean the determinant is also small? Or is there, you know, or is it false? So this is the first attempt to make this thing precise, and you'll see that it's actually, the way it's formulated, the naive way would be false, but then we'll modify it and see what the right question is. So here is the first attempt to make this conjecture formal. And this is our main contribution in this paper is to discuss the conjecture. And let me try first to motivate the conjecture. So here's the first attempt. Assume you have a lattice and you have lots of points. So you have 2 to the n points in a ball of radius square root n. There are tons of points there, very close to the origin. Is it true the determinant has to be less than 1? Okay, that's kind of the naive converse of Minkowski's theorem. And you think about it for a minute, and you see this is too good to be true. This won't be true, and here's a very simple example. Consider this two-dimensional lattice, and imagine it's very, very dense on this one, on those lines. Very, very, very dense. Imagine the spacing here, like 1 over s. S is an enormous number. But between the lines, there are gaps, and those gaps are even bigger. They're like maybe, say, s squared. So that you have this picture in mind of this very dense lines, lots of points on them, but in between the lines, there are like a few astronomical units apart. And if you think about that, well, the determinant here is big. So globally, this thing is actually quite sparse because of the huge gaps between those lines. So the determinant, if you multiply s squared by 1 over s, you get s. So the determinant is very big. S is enormous. But if you take a ball of radius square root n, well, you get lots of points there, of course, because I took this very dense line there. Okay. So the number of points would be maybe s times square root n. So what did we do wrong? Well, this is the first attempt. This, of course, is not true. But here's one thing that might be true. Assume you have a lattice and you have lots of points in radius square root n. You have maybe 2 to the n points. Does it necessarily have a sublattice, namely intersection with subspace? Does it have a subspace where the determinant is less than 1? Maybe that's the right question to ask. And indeed, this is what Dadush asked. This is Daniel's conjecture. Again, I want to say if I have lots of points in a ball, if I see lots of short lattice points, is there a way to explain it? Explain it in the sense, kind of give a witness, in the sense of a subspace where it's also globally dense, where the intersection is, where the determinant is small. Make sense? This is the conjecture. That's the kind of main take-home message. You can also listen to the rest of the talk if you wish. Breaking news. You didn't see it in the New York Times, probably because of the presidential election stuff, but recently, joint work with NOAA, we proved the conjecture, so this should be on the archive, hopefully in a week or two. Always, I've been saying it for a few months, but it should be on the archive in a week or two. So local density does indeed imply global density in a subspace. So this thing I mentioned before is true. Let me make it slightly more formal. Here's the conjecture, now theorem. And I'll do it in the contrapositive to make it more exciting. So if you have a lattice and all sublattices, all subspaces, have determinant at least 1. So there's nowhere any global density. There's no dense line like that that's hiding in there. Then the number of points you have, a norm at most square root n, is at most 2 to the n. Okay, and that's what I wanted to have before. Those parameters, you can play with those parameters. Nothing special about square root n or 2 to the n. More generally, for radius r, we can get something on the order of e to the log squared n r squared. And that's nice because this is essentially tied for Zn, the celebrity lattice I mentioned in the beginning, the simplest of all lattices for Zn. So in some sense, if you want to remember this conjecture, the theorem, you can think of it as saying that in some sense Zn is the densest. Zn is kind of the worst possible lattice in this sense. So I told you that traditionally in this area, people care about the best lattices. They want to minimize the number of points in the ball. And what we're doing here is kind of the dual of that. We want to maximize the number of points. We're asking for the highest number of points you can have under those determinant conditions. So in some sense, the dual to the usual equation you see in this area. So again, the take-home message, this is the conjecture now theorem. And one way to think of it is saying that Zn is the densest. We don't quite prove that, but we prove something along these lines, that Zn is the densest lattice. So there's this log, we lose a log in the exponent, but apart from that, that's what we do. So what else do we do in the paper? Well, just stating conjecture, for that you don't get into Fox. Maybe into Stock, but not Fox. So our results, the first result is that we actually give some evidence. The paper ended up being more than 60 pages long, so we do something there. We prove that, you know, some evidence towards the conjecture. Now it's kind of irrelevant because it's proven, so I'm not boring with this. Let me just tell you that the last thing we do there is kind of cute because we show that some relaxation of the conjecture follows from a very nice theorem by Midman and PZA. So this gave us some confidence that what we're doing is not totally stupid. But again, this is mostly irrelevant because now it's proven. More interesting and more relevant now are the applications, and that's what we spend most of the paper on, showing all sorts of applications of that, you know, conjecture, now theorem. The first one answers the question of self-cost that also arose in connection with crypto applications. I'll show some pictures in the next slide. And the kind of the main application we had is resolving some of the conjecture that Kanan and Lovas had in 88 about the covering radius. So again, just so you hear, give you a few bits and pieces about those things. A third application are some complexity in the crypto applications, just to make the committee happy. So we also had some non-mathematical stuff in there. For instance, covering radius with approximation log n is in CoinP, if you know what that is. But turns out this work does have some applications in more applications in crypto and complexity. So the first application is a question of Laurent Salovkos from Cornell. Let me just mention briefly by pictures. Basically, we're considering what's known as mixing time on flat Tora. You don't have to know definitions. Basically, you have a lattice. This is a two-dimensional lattice, and you imagine that you're kind of doing a Brownian motion around the lattice. So the PDF, I'm drawing a kind of density function of where you are at any given moment. So kind of after 2 seconds, you're here. Maybe after 4 seconds, you're kind of more spread out. After maybe 8 seconds, you're here. Looks like this, you know, mountainous this ridge area, and at some point it becomes very close to flat, right? Because it mixes. And a natural question here that, again, as I mentioned, rose also in connection with crypto applications and also people doing Markov chains. So Salovkos asked, is mixing time in the statistical distance sense, in the L1 sense, would it be the same as the mixing time in the stronger point-wise or the L infinity sense? So usually when we analyze Markov chains, we actually work with L infinity sense. It's easier to analyze. But we usually care about the L1. But L1 is much harder to analyze. So Sal, of course, wondered if the two things would be the same. And what we show here is, yes, it follows from Dadosh's conjecture. Now it's true. The two things are roughly the same. The mixing time in L1 and infinity are roughly the same. It's not always the case. There are acute examples of Markov chains where there are very big gaps between L1 and infinity. It's by Perez and Ravel. There are some examples of that. So this is one application to Markov chains. The main application we had is for the covering radius. I won't show too many details. Let me just tell you that this is a question that Kanan and Lovas came up with in connection with integer programming. And fully resolving it, we're not quite there yet, but fully resolving it might speed up integer programming. And the question is about something called the covering radius. Covering radius is the furthest you can be from a lattice. And for instance, for Zn, the furthest you can be from it is square root n over 2. That's the all 1/2 point. And basically, the motivation for this is the following observation. That if the term is bigger than 1, remember, if the density is, if there's more than 1 unit of volume per each lattice point, then it's not hard to see that the covering radius is bigger than square root n, just by volume arguments. You know, if you imagine there's, you know, take a ball of radius square root n around each lattice point, the volume of this ball, say, is less than 1, Hence, you cannot cover all of space. There are those little gaps in between, and those gaps will be points of distance more than square root n from the lattice. So anyway, this is just a basic observation. And Kanan and Lovaas basically asked something very similar to what Dadush asked, but regarding covering radius and not regarding counting points. Okay. And the question was, does the converse hold? If covering radius is bigger than square root n, does it imply also the terminal has to be big? They were interested in that because of integer programming. And, well, it's not something exactly like that won't be true because of exactly the same reasons before. The covering radius might be big, but because of some issues in subspace. You might imagine kind of a sparse subspace, and that, locally, that subspace causes the covering radius to be big. But the determinant is small because the determinant is also affected by the other dimensions. So if you refine that conjecture, that question you might ask, is it true that if covering radius is bigger than square root n, there would be subspace where the determinant is big? Okay, this was basically what Kanan and Lovaas asked, and we show, yes, this follows from Dadush's conjecture. Okay? So this is the L2 case of the equation. What they ask is for more general norms. It's just for the L2 case. So again, let me just to summarize this, we show that the conjecture now theorem implies related conjecture in the case of covering radius. So it gives us a characterization of covering radius, and this immediately implies all sorts of complexity in crypto application. We have a good witness for when covering radius is big. The witness is in the form of a subspace with a big determinant. And I should say, determinant is probably the only thing we can compute efficiently. Determinant is something we can efficiently compute, hence it becomes a good witness to the fact that either we have lots of lattice points or covering radius is big. That's why we like characterizations in terms of determinants. So let me summarize. Again, most work in this area usually focuses on the minimum number of lattice points in a ball, starting from Minkowski and all the work in the 20th century. What Dadush asks is for the dual question, what's the maximum number of lattice points you can have in a ball under some natural conditions on determinants? What we do in the paper is we formulate a conjecture, we give some evidence towards it, now it's actually proven. We show lots of applications, and we discuss also all sorts of variants of the conjecture. The conjecture, as I said, isn't proven. In some sense, what it tells us, again, is that Zn is the densest. It's not surprising. Typically, you expect other lattices to show up. This seems to be, for us, seems to be the densest, so far, the densest lattice. Some work in progress. This is, apart from the proof of the conjecture, which should be on the archive soon, there's work I did with Shachar Lovett, showing that this theorem implies a counterexample to a certain variant of the Feynman-Wujra conjecture of the integers. It's a conjecture that, it's a variant of the conjecture. No one ever believed it's true. I think Ben Green formulated it and said obviously it's not true, but I don't know how to show it's not true. So I think we managed to do that. There are other applications in Mnesics. This is work of Chris Peikert and my student, Noah Stefan Zavidovich. There are also applications that Dadush and Stefan Davidovich are currently working on algorithms for finding dense sublattices. So just before finishing, let me just say that there are lots of great open questions here, and I'm not just saying it. I really think there's lots of other questions that one can do here. You might ask the same question. You can ask the same question about linear codes, and I think it's interesting to see what it would look like there. I have some guess on what it might look like there. I don't know how natural it would be there, but something like that. Kind of the code with the most number of code words of small Hamming weight. There's also a question we're considering of like instance optimal point counting bounds. This is something that is in the paper, you can see the details. Another question is to solve the full Kanan-Lovaas conjecture, not just for the L2 norm. Currently, we're only doing it for the L2 norm. Another question which we really like is whether Zn is really the densest. Currently, we're showing asymptotically up to some log. If Zn is really the truly unique maximizer, it will imply a conjecture for very nice conjecture of Minkowski. Again, you can read all about this in the paper. So I'll stop there. Thank you.
Any questions? Yes, Guy.
Yeah, one of the things we do in the paper is showing that for random lattices, it's all okay. Yeah, it's very node dense. Random lattices is like random code. It's very good. It has very few points. It's actually, it has no point within distance square root n. So we want kind of the opposite. We want to make it as dense as possible, as many points as possible. Thank you. So, yeah, good question. So it gives, when you formulate precisely and it gives what you would expect, there's still, when I mentioned this instance optimal, there's still a question there whether you can really find, locate all the subspaces of all dimensions. So this is maybe what you're hinting at. But yeah, it gives some information about that. Yeah. But that's, yeah. That's a separate talk. I didn't talk about the theorem or the...
Okay, let's thank the speaker again. Yeah.